Nehemiah chapter 7, turn there if you would. Tonight and next Sunday night, we'll end our series on spiritual leadership. We've examined prayer, compassion, listening, faithfulness, loneliness, evaluation, clarity, confidence, involvement, ridicule, dedication, perseverance, finishing the job, working, discouragement, integrity, rebuke, and conviction. And tonight, we're going to be looking at rewards, the Bible, and humility, and then three more next Sunday night. Lord willing, we will finish up the series. And each one of these categories, we've shown them in Nehemiah's life. Again, Nehemiah was a cupbearer, and he wasn't a natural-born leader, but he took the call of God seriously on his life, this mission of rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem, and God used him in a mighty way, and we see that Nehemiah used these leadership characteristics in the rebuilding of the wall, and they're preserved in the Word of God for us. They're good for pastors, they're good for fathers, they're good for husbands, they're good for wives, they're good for the lost in your workplace. Nehemiah, notice with me chapter 7, and we'll begin reading in verse 1, rewards in leadership. Now, when I say that tonight, for many of us, we think of rewards of being in leadership as pay raise. Amen? So, no, that's not what I'm talking about. We look at rewards in leadership of some benefits or some promises that might be made to us, and that's not what we're talking about either. Notice Nehemiah chapter 7, verse 1. That came to pass when the wall was built, and I had set up the doors, and the porters, and the singers, and the Levites were appointed. So the walls are finished, the courses of the priesthood, the service of the temple, all of that is set in place. Verse 2, and I gave my brother Hanani, and Hanani, the ruler of the palace, charge over Jerusalem, for he was a faithful man and feared God above many. Rewards in leadership, very simply, do not ever reward someone who is unfaithful with the task of leadership in the church. An unfaithful man, as the Bible tells us, is like a broken tooth or a foot out of joint. I've had a broken tooth chip, that is, but nothing serious. I've had a broken leg, and I have broke my arm twice, and I can tell you, broken bones hurt a lot, as a matter of fact. I've broken two or three fingers and one or two toes. In Uganda, we'd get these calls at night about 2 o'clock in the morning, and the light electricity would be off, and there's not a room that's level in the house. They've all got steps everywhere they're going, or furniture is there, and you know it's a call from America, and you don't know how long it's been ringing before you woke up, and there you are in the dark trying to get to the phone. No mobile phones, by the way. That's the one with the cord, you know, deet, 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 or turn. When I first went to Uganda survey trip, they actually had the crank phones. It was that bad. They cranked it to get the power up to get the hold of the operator in town. And sometimes they had to send the kid into town to get the switchboard operator to actually plug in the cable. That's how it was on my survey trip in 1994 in Uganda. So they'd be rushing to the phone and stub a toe on the phone. Here you are talking about something very serious. It hurts so bad. That's the way it is to put confidence in an unfaithful man, to put confidence in an unfaithful lady or woman. Very similar. So Nehemiah rewards his brother, and he takes over leadership in Jerusalem. Why? He gives two qualifications for this. One, because he feared God. He feared God. He wanted to serve God, wanted to love God, and he established his fear of God in the fact that he was a faithful man. You look at the life of Nehemiah as he's going through his leadership characteristics. The thing that keeps coming up over and over and over and over again is Nehemiah is a determined, and Nehemiah is a faithful man in the things of God. And he rewards this man, his brother. What should we do? How should we reward others? Let me give you two thoughts. One, we should reward those who do normal things. And we ought to reward those who do extra normal things or abnormal things. What do I mean by normal things? I mean just general faithfulness, just being faithful to God. How about those who love God, show that affection? And in their life, they demonstrate godliness and desire to follow the Lord and honesty and character. We ought to reward those in leadership. leadership and giving leadership to those who exercise and show a normal Christian life. I'm not talking about an extra normal Christian life. I'm just talking about a normal Christian life. Now, that's not normal so much today. You know, for example, the believers in Thessalonica and Berea were noble believers. They were exceptional. They were above board. They were far beyond those believers in Thessalonica. I'm talking about the normal as what should be in a believer's experience. That's unusual today. As a matter of fact, we look at most pastors today and most believers today who are just doing the normal things according to the Word of God, and we have a tendency to look at them and say, they're such an unusual person. They're such a person of great character. And the reality is, I wouldn't be worthy of untying or tying the shoes of Dr. Lee Robertson or even Dr. Mike Allison, either one. You understand what I'm saying? Today, we take the usual as being unfaithful. And we're talking about rewarding leadership and authority in someone who does the normal biblical things of faithfulness, of godliness, of honesty. But then we ought to reward those that are extra normal or that would be abnormal. That is people who go far beyond their duty and far beyond their responsibilities. I'll just give you a statement, and there's only probably a couple of people here know the one in particular that I'm talking about, but a certain situation came up in the last few weeks, and someone stepped up and did what was responsible and did it in a great way, and I sent them an SMS and just simply said to them, thank you for stepping in. What a blessing that was. And the response was, I was just doing what I was supposed to do. That's what she was doing. I was doing what I was supposed to do. I just saw a need. I jumped in and I took care of it. That's normal. But the abnormal is a believer who's willing to go the second mile, willing to go up, above, and beyond just what's required. Jesus said, I talked about the servant, and said, if you've just done what you're supposed to do, call yourself an unprofitable servant. In other words, if we just do what we're supposed to do, and we just do what we're commanded to do, that's normal. But going beyond that is abnormal, and going beyond that is extra, and we ought to be willing to go the second mile. What should reward them with? Responsibility. Caretaking of the church. We ought to reward them with more authority in the church. We ought to promote the faithfulness and godliness as Nehemiah does to his brother, giving them a thank you, a pat on the back, giving them incentives to continue to serve the Lord and encouragement. That's not what usually happens. As a matter of fact, it was very funny some years ago. It's been 10, 15 years ago now. I was on furlough in America, and I came home church on Wednesday. And so I walked in, and Pastor Allison greeted me. We're talking around. He said, you'll never guess what happened today. And I said, well, I don't know. I mean, like what? He said, Brian Brown got his first complaint today. I said, really? Somebody would complain about Pastor Brian Brown. He said, yeah, we took him on staff today. He's been a member of our church for over 10 years. No one has ever complained about him. No one has ever said a bad word about him. The first day on staff, I get a call and somebody's complaining about Brown. He said, I told him, welcome to the ministry. That was funny. And I'm sure he's got a few complaints since then. But reward those who are being faithful to the Lord. Notice also, not just rewarding them, but notice he also practices Bible in leadership. Nehemiah chapter 8, if you would, next chapter over. We'll read here the first 12 verses, and then we'll look at verse 18. Nehemiah chapter 8. And all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate, and they spake to Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel. Oh, what a joy! Can you imagine that everyone, can you imagine every member of IBC, all the people would gather themselves together on a Sunday morning and demand preaching from the Word of God? Well, after that happened, I'd have a heart attack. And if everybody ever showed up at the same time, everybody, it just seems like everybody can miss at the same time, but not everybody can come at the same time. And it would be really exciting if that ever happened, and I would probably have a heart attack. I just couldn't believe that would take place. Why did God bless Nehemiah? Why did God bless the people in building the wall? As the noble believers this morning, these people wanted the word of God. They wanted a pastor. They wanted Nehemiah to give them the word. And he was a ready scribe in the word of God. Matter of fact, let me look back here. Revelation. Nehemiah chapter 8 and verse 1. No, it's not the one. Anyway, verse 2. And Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding, upon the first day of the seventh month. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate. That's where they ask him. He read from morning until midday. Imagine, from 8 o'clock to 12. 4 hours. They stood. They listened to the word of God. Before the men and women and those that could understand, the ears of all the people were attentive, that is, they were noble, attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood. That's where we get this from, having a pulpit. And they, which they had made for the purpose, and beside him stood. Now notice, going down to verse 5, and Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people when he opened it, and the people stood up. He was on a pulpit of wood, and he was on an elevated place where people could readily see him. They stood up. Why do we stand the reading of the word of God? It's just a simple show of respect. Verse 6, and Ezra blessed the Lord and the great God, and all the people answered, amen, amen. Hey, buddy, they said it in the Old Testament, amen. All right, there we go, here we go. With lifting up their, oh, we don't do that, do we? Wow, how about that? Now, what did they do in the Old Testament? They had a pulpit of wood, he stood on a platform, and he read the word of God, and the people went, amen! Lifted up holy hands, too. Notice what it says. Lifting up their hands, but notice, bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Now, that's an act of humility. You know, the Bible says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and will heal their land. Notice in verse 8, so they read in the book of the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. He was preaching. He was reading the word and he was explaining the word of God, just like I'm doing right now this evening. In verse 9, and Nehemiah, which is Trishita, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord your God. Mourn not, nor weep, for all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Public expression of repentance. Now, we're afraid to cry today. We're afraid to come forward and kneel in front of someone. That's just called pride. That's what that's called. Notice in verse 10. Then he said unto them, go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet, send portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be you sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. So the priest stilled all the people, saying, hold your peace, for the day is holy. Neither be ye grieved. And all the people went their way to eat and to drink and to send portions to make great mirth, because they had understood the words that were declared unto them. Verse 18. Also day by day, from the first day and the last, the feast, he read in the book of the law of God, and they kept the feast 7 days. On the eighth day was a solemn assembly according unto the manner. Imagine 8 days just like this. From morning, maybe early morning until midday, hearing and preaching. That's where we get a lot of our what's called camp meetings in America, or conferences in America, where we get together and there's just a bunch of preachers or evangelists there, and preaching in the morning and preaching in the afternoon and preaching in the evening. Why? We need preaching. That's why. We need to be challenged and encouraged with the Word of God. Nehemiah shared and showed the walls had to be constructed, and they were reconstructed. Now the people need to be reconstructed. How is a godly spiritual leader going to lead his people according to the Word of God? Listen to some American presidents. George Washington, America's first president, quote, said, "It is impossible to rightly govern a nation and a world without the Bible." That's why we're in such pitiful shape that we are right now. Andrew Jackson, the seventh American president, said, "It is this book, the Bible, the rock on which the republic stands." Woodrow Wilson, the 28th president, said, "I ask every man and woman in this audience today that from this day forward they will realize that part of the destiny of America lies in the daily pursuit of this great book." That sounds like a preacher today, don't it? No, most preachers wouldn't say that. This was the position of American presidents all the way through until modern times. What is essential? Why is it essential for the spiritual leader, the pastor, to use the Bible? Let's go, hold your place there in the book of Nehemiah, but let's go to the book of Psalms. In the book of Psalms, and I want you to notice the chapter on the Bible, the longest chapter in our Bible, Psalms 119, and let me give you a few thoughts. Why is it important to use the Word of God? Nehemiah thought it was very important. David thought it was very important. God used him to write Psalms chapter 119. Notice, first of all, in 119, notice in verse 2, every verse in Psalms 119 says something specific about the Word of God. Don't worry, we're not going to do a whole chapter, just a few verses. Verse 2, "Blessed are they that keep His testimonies and that seek Him with the whole heart." Keeping His testimonies, keeping the Word of God. The Word of God brings a blessing. You don't know the Word of God, it's not going to bring a blessing. Notice verse 9. "Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed there according to thy word." Now there is cleansing in the Word of God. There's blessing. Eternal salvation is in the Word of God. Growth is in the Word of God. God's richest blessings in obedience to the Word of God comes by God's blessings. Notice verse 9 again. That's cleansing. Being cleansed from our sin. Notice in chapter 119, notice in verse 24, he says, "Thy testimonies also are my delight and my counselors." Notice verse 105. 105, the Bible says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." The Bible brings blessings. The Bible brings cleansing. The Bible brings counsel. The counsel of the Lord standeth forever, and the thoughts of his hearts to all generations. He wants to give us counsel and wisdom and understanding in his will found in the Word of God. Notice Psalms 119, go back to verse 43. It brings blessing. It brings cleansing. It brings counsel. It brings hope. Notice Psalms 119, notice verse 43. The Bible says, "And take not the word of truth utterly out of thy mouth, for I have hoped in thy judgments." Notice in verse 74, "They that fear thee will be glad when they see me, because I have hoped in thy word." Verse 81, "My soul fainteth for thy salvation, but I hope in thy word." When things are going well, our hope is in the Word of God. When things are not going well, our hope is in the Word of God. When we have victory, our hope is in the Word of God. We have defeat, our hope is in the Word of God. When things look confusing and misunderstanding of what God may be doing in your life, your hope is still in the Word of God. That's where hope is. It's found in that. A Bible hope is not the hope, "I hope one day my ship comes in." Well, mine would run aground before it ever got to shore, all right? So my ship's never coming in. It'd never make it to shore if I had one. My hope is not if something will happen. My hope is in the security and the essence of God's nature found in His Word. "Thy Word," is the Bible says, "I have magnified my Word above my name." We've been talking about the names of God. God said, "I've magnified this book, this Word, above my own name. There's some real hope for the believer. Notice there's understanding. Now Psalms 119, back to verse 71. It is good for me, I have been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes. Notice, if you would, in verse 130, the entrance of thy word giveth light, it giveth understanding to the simple. We have God's word to give us understanding of God's will, God's way, God's work in our life. So what should we do with the Bible? Notice in Psalms 119, verse 97, we should meditate upon it. How I love thy law. It is my meditation all the day. You meditate on the Word of God. You find some truth in the Word, and it sustains you. Notice Psalm 119, 148. Mine eyes prevent the night watches, that I might meditate in thy Word. I miss some sleep, so I can meditate on the Word of God. Joshua said, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Comes from the Word of God. Psalms 119, 165, it brings peace. The Bible says, notice you at 165, great peace have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Find somebody gets offended, they don't love the Word of God. Wow, that's pretty tough, isn't it? If you get offended easily, your problem is with your relationship with God and His Word. So all that Nehemiah did in his leadership, we see that he gave rewards to faithful, godly, God-fearing men who helped him. That's the way it should be. We give rewarding leadership and authority and position to those who love God. I can tell you this, many a deacon, before he was a deacon, would be a man of great character and great worth and great love and great compassion. And then he gets on the deacon board. We don't have one of those, by the way. But he gets to be a deacon. All of a sudden, he's in a position of authority, and his whole character begins to change. Instead of a servant, he becomes a boss of what's going to take place in a church. My mom asked me one time, this is 15 years ago or so, probably my first furlough. My mom asked me when I got home, she said, would you ever think about leaving the field and coming back to American pastor? I told her, yeah, sure. That's what mom wanted to hear. I told her, yeah, sure, okay. She said, really? I'm surprised. She said, what would it take for you to come home? I said, well, you know, after all, it'd have to be a big church. And I see a little grin going up my mom's side of the face. You know, she knows I'm starting to put her on. I said, it'd have to be a big church, really nice buildings and things like that, and could pay me a full-time salary. And she grinned real big, and she said, you know, that's possible. I said, but that's not all. She said, it's not. She said, what else is required? I said, every deacon of the church has to resign the day I become pastor. Every Sunday school teacher has to resign the day I become pastor. Every janitor has to resign the day I become pastor. Every treasurer has to resign the day I become pastor. Everybody has to resign. I'm the only one that holds an office. And my mom looked at me and she said, you know, there's not a church in America that would do that. And I said, and that's exactly why I wouldn't want to come back to America and pastor. And she said, really? I said, Mama, I'd probably put everybody back in exactly where they were if they loved God. But that's what they'd have to be willing to do. You see, this Nehemiah's brother had proved himself in building the wall. He proved himself in the Word of God, and he was rewarded. Nehemiah's effort to reward the man was because he was in the Word of God. And Ezra built the people after building the wall on the Word of God. And lastly tonight, notice humility in leadership. In Nehemiah chapter 9, back to the book of Nehemiah, chapter 9, and look with me, if you would, in verses 1 through 3. Now in the 20th and 4th day of this month, the children of Israel were assembled with fasting, with sackcloth, and earth upon them. And the seed of Israel separated themselves from all strangers, and stood and confessed their sins and iniquities of their fathers. And they stood up in their place and read in the book of the law of the Lord their God 1/4 part of the day, and another 1/4 part they confessed and worshiped the Lord their God. We're just too stinking proud. That's all there is to it. Notice what it says here. They stood in their place and read in the book of the law of their God 1/4 part of the day. 3 or 4 hours? they read the Word of God. And another fourth part, they confessed and worshiped before the Lord their God. They confessed their sins and the sins of their fathers. Notice it says in verse 2, and stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. It doesn't mean here, it doesn't imply to me that they just stood up and prayed silently so nobody would know. It seems here that they stood up and were brought to attention to everyone else by their standing to confess their sin publicly before others. I would say that's humility. I'd say that's wanting to get right with God and wanting to get right with others. Some years ago, when we first started the church, Uganda Baptist Church of Tororo, Apoya Martin, and many of you met him. Apoya Martin, the father of Pastor Jalugi, became a member of the church. And Pastor Jalugi wanted to be a member of the church when the first church first started, but we wouldn't let him because he wasn't married, the dowry wasn't paid. And when he got the dowry paid, he got married properly, then he became a member of the church, because it wouldn't do any good to vote him into membership in the morning and then church discipline him and vote him out of the church in the night because he wasn't married. All right? And so anyway, Martin came to me early on. I've told you this testimony before. And he'd gotten saved and he had wanted to confess something to me. And it led privately through an interpreter that he had three women, not married to any of them. So he's living basically, he's in his late 50s and basically he's living with three women. He's never been married and had children with all of them. You understand that? And so in process of that, he wanted to get right with God about that, and he did. Some years later, when we had gone, Karen and I, to start another church in Chotera, Uganda, about 8.5-9 hours from Tororo, we came back to check on the ministry, as we did, and I was actually literally at that point almost pastoring two different churches in two different places. And I got there, and Pastor Jalugi, who was not the pastor at that moment, got me aside, and he said, I want you to know, my dad has gone back to living with all three women. I thought, man, he's got that fixed. He knows that's not right. Well, a missionary told him, since you're already married to them, all three of them are your wives. Well, he wasn't married to any of them, so none of them could be there. None of them were his wives. But when one got saved, he married her, but now he's going back to living with all three of the women. So I went to see Apoya Martin that afternoon after church, and I said to him, I said, Martin, next week we're having the Lord's Supper, and I want you to know you're invited to come. He said, I'm not coming. I said, it doesn't matter whether you come or not. We're having the Lord's Supper. You're a member of the church. And that night, you're going to take the Lord's Supper, or you're not going to take the Lord's Supper, and I'm not going to give it to you because you're in sin, and everybody here in the village knows about it. Everybody in town knows about it, and you've caused blasphemy to the cause of Christ, and you've hurt the ministry here of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what are you going to do? He wouldn't repent. And I said, all right, I'm going to pray. If I were you, I'd be a little nervous. And so that Sunday afternoon to take the Lord's Supper, Martin showed up and came over and sat down. There was a holy hush in the auditorium. He's here. And I preached, had the invitation. He didn't come forward. I was hoping he'd come forward. I hoped he'd get things right. He didn't. He's still sitting back there. I'm thinking, oh no, what's going to happen here? Because I'm not giving him the Lord's Supper, and he's in sin before God. And Lord, give me wisdom how to handle that. And about that time, as I'm praying quietly and getting things just prepared to begin the Lord's Supper, Martin stood up. Can I say a few words? Well, sure. And that few moments, about 5-10 minutes, that man confessed all of his sin before the church publicly. Told him exactly what he was doing. It's like, whoa. I asked their forgiveness with tears. You know what happened that night? One of the greatest services I've ever been in. When he got through and sat down, before we even actually passed out the elements of the Lord's Supper, someone else stood up over here on this other side and said, Pastor, can I have a word? Yeah. Well, Pastor, my life's not right. I've been stealing money at work. And another one got up and stood, Pastor, can I say something? Sure. Almost everybody, almost as far as I know everybody, stood up that night and publicly before God and each other confessed their sins, and even crossed the aisles of the church and got right with one another. At 12 o'clock that night, you heard that. At 12 o'clock that night, I looked at them and said, I've got to go home. I have got to go to bed. I am exhausted. It's been a long day. It's been a sweet day. And there was a presence of the Holy Spirit in that place that I've only sensed a few times in my life. And I went home and I looked at them and I said, are you going to stay up all night? They said, sure, we have to. Why? We're afraid tomorrow. God won't be as real in this place as he is right now. And they just wanted to stay there. You see, there's humility in leadership. A leader must possess humility. And as I say that, you're looking at me right now and you're judging, is he humble? The answer is no. I am not humble. You know, once you think you have humility, it's over. You don't have humility. Every one of us has enough stinking pride that oozes from our glands that just makes our spiritual life and condition before God stink to high heaven with pride body odor. When you believe that you're humble, you have a real problem with pride. We are by nature proud. We are by nature arrogant. We are by nature self-willed. We are by nature demanding, I'm going to have my way. There's children in the back. They'll testify that sometime today. I want that. That's mine. And that's just exactly how most of us act as well. Humility doesn't mean that you don't have pride. The humility says, I can humble myself before God. God's people here in the book of Nehemiah learn to humble themselves before God and before one another. They were in fastings. They were in sackcloth. They showed their separation. They confessed their sin. Proverbs 15:33 says, the fear of the Lord is the instruction of wisdom, and before honor is humility. Proverbs 18:12, before destruction, the heart of man is haughty. Before honor is humility. James 4:6, God resisteth the proud, but he giveth grace to the humble. He doesn't just resist the proud, wicked government official or the proud, wicked guy in the bar right now. He says he resists pride, your pride, my pride. God resists our pride. 1 Peter 5:5 says, yea, and all of you be subject one to another and be clothed with humility. In Philippians chapter 2, we have the humility of Christ. He says in verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took on him the form of a servant. He says, no reputation means he humbled himself. I will guarantee you that there's no greater example than the Lord Jesus Christ leaving his throne, leaving heaven, and taking on the form of a man and dying for our sins and becoming part of his creation. How can we learn to be humble? Well, don't talk about yourself. You know what happens when you're boasting? You're actually gossiping about yourself, or when you're complaining, you're actually gossiping about yourself. What it shows is you think more highly of yourself than God thinks of you, because God's allowed everything to happen in our lives. And everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. It didn't say give thanks because it was good. It just said give thanks because God's allowed it in your life for your good. Don't talk about yourself. Everything is not about you. It's not about me. It's about him. Don't think about yourself. Well, if I made this decision, or if I did that, or I took this course, or I did that. No, don't think about yourself. Don't expect things from others. Don't be looking for people to praise you. Don't be looking for people's adoration of you. Don't look for people's approval. I say that. If I walk out tonight, don't do it tonight, don't do it tonight, but if I walk out tonight and somebody slaps me on the back and says, preacher, that's a good message. I've learned over the years to let that go in one ear and out the other one. I was listening to a pastor this week, and Dr. Curtis Hudson was saying, when he pastored back in Georgia, and he said, I've never been proud of one message I've ever preached. I'm thinking, well, I understand that. I went home today thinking, man, I forgot to say that, and I forgot to say that. I didn't mean to get carried away with that. Well, all I know is my heart was right before God. I'd studied what I had prepared, and I just trust God used me and he used you to hear his word. Jack Hyle said one time, somebody asked him, said, when do you preach your worst message? And he said, every time I get finished and think I've preached a good one. That's the problem. Learn self-denial. Learn to say no. Saturday is my splurge day. I have, the last 5 weeks, I've walked 40 to 45 kilometers a week. I've lost now 4.5 kilos in the last 5 weeks because of my sugar. And Saturday is my splurge day. Saturday is my day to go off the diet. And so yesterday afternoon, all I had was a small cappuccino and 4 biscuits. That's it. And my sugar level last night jumped to the highest point of diabetic. And this morning, it was still high. I tested it when I got home. It's back to the normal range. And I'm thinking, 1 cappuccino? 4 biscuits? That's all? And you know what my flesh says? That ain't fair. That ain't fair. Do I want biscuits every day? No. Do I want cappuccinos every day? Yes. But you know what it is to say no to yourself? It's a good thing. Self-discipline shows humility. What do I deserve? Well, I'll tell you what I deserve. I deserve to take care of my health so my quality of life can help me to serve God. And that's far more important than at least a flavored cappuccino or biscuits. You understand what I'm saying? You have to decide in humility what is the important part. Now, listen, he says here in Ephesians, or 1 Peter 1:5, be clothed with humility. Wow. Galatians 6:1 says, if a brother be overtaken in a fault, ye that are spiritual, restore such one in a spirit of meekness, humility. You don't go to someone to rebuke them because you're high and mighty. You don't go to rebuke somebody because you're better than they are. You go with humility. You go with your head bowed. You go with the attitude, I'm here to help you. That's how you go. That should be for all of us. And then just simply learn to live life simple. We don't have to have all the gadgets. We don't have to have the latest of everything. We don't need to have everything everybody else has. In America, it's called keeping up with the Joneses. I got in that habit. I got in that trap when I first got into the ministry as an associate pastor. I wanted the fishing rod he had. I wanted the car he had. I realized I got some of those things, and they didn't really bring any satisfaction. All I have to have is what I need to serve God with. That's what I need. That's humility. Humility comes with a price. Self-denial. Humility comes, I'll serve when people criticize me. I'll love them even though they won't return that love to me. I'll be faithful to them even if they're not faithful to me. Those are marks of humility. And somebody has to have their way, and someone puts on that arrogance. God says he resists the proud. The believer comes to you like that, all the red flags should go up immediately. And you should be very wary of the things that come out of their mouth and be sure you're still clothed with humility to deal with them. We see these three aspects continue on of Nehemiah's leadership. He learned to reward those who are faithful and godly. He rewarded those with the Bible. That was the importance of his leadership, the foundation of his principles. And he also had, and the people illustrated. You understand, Nehemiah had the humility. And his leadership has caused the people to take that humility and the scripture to their heart to repent before God. And that's how come Nehemiah is in the Bible. That's how come God has blessed us with this testimony, is because of the man who just simply says, I want to rebuild the walls. God, use me. Give me wisdom. Next Sunday night, we'll conclude with the last three, being separated. Wherefore, come out among them and be separate, saith the Lord, about godliness in stewardship and in decision making. Let's stand and I will be dismissed in prayer. Father, we thank you tonight for your love for us. We thank you tonight for a good day, Bible Institute, marriage counseling. Lord, we didn't have baptismal services today, but we've had some sickness as well. We pray for these that have some fears of COVID and some lingering effects in their families. We pray for complete healing this week from them, that they'll be able to reunite with us in union as we fellowship around the Word of God, even Wednesday night, but especially Sunday mornings. Pray that you'd keep us safe as we go our separate ways this evening. Pray, Lord, that you'd help us to take Nehemiah's examples of leadership and godliness and faithfulness and humility and taking the Word of God to meditate upon it, seeking your truths to change our lives, change our thoughts, change our understanding. Help us to be more like Jesus. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, you're dismissed tonight.